about placing our fields a little bit and how to create them. And then eventually I switched over to laser tweezers because that's where I want to use them. So we continue on laser tweezers today. And so basically I want to show you that laser tweezers is very powerful technology or technique or part of physics which enables us to measure forces and torques in very, very special circumstances. So one of the things that we would normally look at if we look at optical tweezers is that really it can be characterized as a particle which is put into potential of this sort. So we have harmonic potential here, and the particle is trapped in this potential, and depending where it is in the trap is stiffer or weaker. And if I now will increase the power of the laser with which I'm doing this trapping, then the walls of the potential will get steeper and the particle will be trapped much stronger. So all that can be described by this equation that we saw not long ago. William was showing it. And this is how the particle behaves, and we saw it yesterday. So this time, what I'm doing is that I have my optical setup that we discussed, and instead of moving the stage around, I'm moving the laser beam around. So I'm moving this potential around while I trap the particle. So the particle is staying in the trap, and I'm moving it in X, Y. And of course, I can move it in Z as well, because it's three-dimensionally trapped, this three-dimensional potential, and the particle is three-dimensionally trapped. However, I'm not doing it here because it would mean that what I have to do is to refocus the microscope, so it wouldn't look that nice. But believe me, it's three-dimensional. Okay, so then what I can do is I can follow, you could see before, if we look at this, trapping mechanism here, you can see that although the particle is trapped, it's very difficult to see, but it's wiggling around a little bit around its equilibrium position. And that's the Brownian motion that we are looking at. And we can use the Brownian motion of this particle to then describe how strong the trap is and calculate the stiffness. So we can look at the dynamics of the trap all the time we travel the particle. So there are several ways of doing it. Experimentally, I can have very, very fast camera that are available now, and we can track the movement of the particle with the camera, or we can have another type of detector, like quadrant detector, and look at the displacements of the particle in time. And then we can plot x squared here versus time, and we'll get this very typical curve that describes Brownian motion of the particle. And then if we now plot power spectrum density as a function of frequency that we were doing it with, then we can see that we'll get this typical curve here which describes the power spectrum of the particle in the potential that is drawn here. So this role of frequency that we see here, F0, and we can determine that, and we can also determine trap stiffness. And obviously this is done for a specific size of the particle, because it will be very sensitive to the size of the particle, of course, and we'll look at it in more details later, and then I'm fitting it to the Lorentz function. And so the stiffness of the trap is determined by this role of frequency times the size of the particle times the viscosity of the medium in which we are doing it all. So with that, we can say that the trap is weak or strong, or stiffness is large or small. But the role of this typical function will always have this type of behavior as you are seeing on this curve. But with that, this means that I can characterize the trap very well. Okay, so the other thing I can do is, this is what I was showing you yesterday, that if I have a beam beam of light coming towards my particle, of course the particle acts as a lens. It will scatter the light and will refocus the light in a particular way. And if I follow what's happening with this light which is transmitted through the particle, I can then analyze my track very carefully. So here what I do is I do scattering theory of Lorentz mean. That means that the approximation here is that the particles are very small, so they are at the largest, about half of the wavelengths of light with which I'm doing it. And I assume certain convergence angle of my beam. That means that I still have very high numerical aperture lens that I'll be doing this this experiment with, or calculations with. And of course, refractive index of the trapped object versus the surrounding is also very important. So what we have here is basically silica in water. Okay, so this is what we are calculating here. Okay, so now we have two situations here. Here I am below the focus of the light, so the focus of the light is here. The particle sits a little bit below. This is how the line, field lines will look like. And if the particle is to the right of the focus, then the field lines will see that the bending of the light is very obvious in this particular case. And by studying this field lines, I can characterize my trap very well. Okay, so now I also want to model my optical trap. So this modeling allows me, I don't know why it says M of U, some kind of slipped in. I want to be able to simulate a variety of conditions. I want to look at the typical parameters like refractive index and radius of the particle. And what we have developed in my lab are very rapid calculations. And if you go onto my webpage, there is a link to Optical Toolbox. This Optical Toolbox is exactly what I will be showing you here today. So this enables your calculations of the situations in the trap, depending on what sort of particle you trap and in what sort of beam you trap the particle in. Whether it's Gaussian beam, whether it's Gauss-Laguerre beam, etc., etc. What we also do, which I won't be doing here, is that we not only consider trapping particles which are spherical, but we also trap other type of particles, like elongated, very long particles, like rods and ellipsoids and so on and so forth. And those calculations can be done for those type of particles as well. So here's one calculation which shows quite an interesting thing. So basically, I'll show you in a few slides what those calculations are based upon, but what I'm trying to show here is that I look at refractive index of the particles that I want to trap. So I'm going from some sort of glass up to diamond, and here I'm looking at the particle size. And what these colors show is what sort of force is acting on those particles. So when will they be trapped, and when will they be impossible to trap? And what we can see here is that depending on the size of the particle, so if I'm in this sort of region, the red means it's very strong force, so the particle is strongly trapped, and then blue means there's no force acting on it. So you can see what we were saying yesterday, that if the particle is really very small, no matter what the refractive index, it's very difficult to trap it. And it has to do with the fact that its polarizability of the particle is, if it's very small, it's negligible, so it's difficult to exert any forces on it. But then what we can also see here is that this is sort of like an interference pattern here. There are resonances in which the particles can be trapped, and in between them, they cannot be trapped. So if we go to diamond, which has refracted index of 2.4, those resonances are very narrow. So there will be places in which such a particle could be trapped, but the width of the size in which they would be able to be trapped is very, very small. So that's pretty interesting, because often it is, you will talk to people who do optical tweezers and they will go on about refractive index of the particle in the medium, which are the best particles to be trapped. And this is based upon this particular curve. And then we can go into Z direction. So I told you that we have three-dimensional trapping, and that landscape changes a little bit, but we can see that if the refract, so it's much harder to trap particles in Z direction, and it's just because the forces in Z directions are much smaller. And so this curve becomes even more sensitive to the refractive index of the particles themselves. So you can see that this very strong trapping now is narrowed very much. And again, if we go to diamond, again, those resonances are very narrow. Although there are many, but they are very narrow. So very careful, yeah?
What's the physical reason for these resonances?
Okay, so this has to do with the interference phenomena, which are occurring in the particle itself, and also in the surrounding. So what happens is that you are doing it in a liquid, and so if you are quite close to the walls, there is change of refractive index, and so on. But the most importantly, what happens is that you have interference phenomena in the particle itself. So and so if you look at the outcoming light, whether it's reflected or transmitted light, you will have basically interference occurring. So that's the physics behind. Okay, so computational modeling enables us to determine forces in torque which result from the scattering. And most of the methods of computational light scattering assume plane wave illumination. And clearly, tweezers do not have plane wave illumination. Okay? So this is what we were talking about yesterday, that in everything that I was showing you yesterday, we were assuming that we have paraxial approximation. So I'm looking at the beams which are very close to optical axis. However, in tweezers, it is not so. But I can do repeated calculations requiring for different incident conditions and need ability to model. Now I say birefringence and non-axisymmetric objects is because very soon I will show you that if what happens if we trap birefringent particles. Does everybody know what birefringence means? Okay. So basically something quite special happens if our particles that we trap can act as lambda over four plates. Okay, especially in circularly polarized light, but we'll come to that. So the method that we are using for calculation is described here. So we are using vector spherical wave functions and T-matrix formalism. So here is the description of my incoming and outgoing field represented in terms of expansions of vector spherical wave functions. So this is incoming field, outgoing field, and we have this T-matrix operator and Hilbert space description of the scattering. So these are the parameters that I want to determine here, and there is my T-matrix, which I will be using to do that. Okay, so what is happening here is described a little bit in this pictorial here. So I have particle-like interaction. I assume some sort of geometrical object. I would have very large particles, and in Rayleigh scattering, the diameters will be very small. And then I can use general Lorentz mean theory for all sizes, if it's exact, but a little bit complicated. So basically, what we have, I have Maxwell equation. I have my laser and the microscope. This is the monochromatic wave. I have vector Helmholtz equation that I have to solve. And I get this general solution, which is the superposition of vector spherical wave functions. So that's what I'm trying to do. Okay, so this is my Helmholtz equation here. And then I characterize both B and B field here with the parameters that I need to do the proper scattering calculation. And I find then expansion coefficients. Incident beams coefficients are A and B. I find the scattering field coefficients, which are P and Q. And then with the boundary conditions for me solutions, I find the field for the specific problem. So this is specific type of beam or specific type of particle or both. And here is one of such calculations done. So this is a field incident on a particle and it's exactly, particle is exactly in the center of the beam, and we could see how the field was propagating. So the incoming E field is coming this way, and we're looking at the field through the particle. Okay, so that helps us to determine then the coefficients in using our T matrix then that can be reused for further calculations. Now we want to also be able to find torques, and we'll see a little bit later why I'm interested in torques. Obviously, if something is rotating, then the torque will be exerted, and I will be rotating a lot of things, so I want to exert torque, calculate torque. I want to look at the reaction force on the particles or trapped objects. So again, I'm using vector spherical wave functions, and they are eigenfunctions of this transverse, and then I calculate the torque. And the torque, we have this incoming parameters here, and outgoing parameters that we were calculating before. And so once we have determined the electric field before, we can also determine the torque. And the only thing that we have to know is the power of the light that we are using here. Okay, so again, this I showed you before, but I wanted to show you that from these calculations, when we are looking at this general theory, and having this in E fields written here, we can calculate the total force in two dimensions. So this is position Z, Z position of the particle, and this is X position of the particle. And we can see that we have particle in front of the beam waves. This is equilibrium position, and particle behind the beam waves. And the same way, we can look at it in X direction. You can see that the forces here in X direction, maximum forces exerted are stronger than in Z direction for a typical particle of the size that I'm defining here. So this is what happens when we do these calculations. So this is a single beam trap. And what happens when the particle is going into the trap? And this is quite interesting because I'm putting the particle first from above, and then I'm putting the particle from below. And the trajectory can also be very easily calculated, that they are not identical trajectories. The particle doesn't necessarily come into the trap in a very straight forward trajectory. It's a rather complicated trajectory. And it is interesting to know this trajectory if for some reason one of the methods for determining forces is one where we are pulling the trap and trying to see how far we can pull it, what accelerations we can attain before the particle falls out of the trap. And that can be studied, all that can be studied in minute details, because as you see, this is the trapping field, and this is the transmitted field through the particle. And you can see that it's very, very sensitive. The position of it and the intensity profile of it is very, very sensitive to the position of the particle in the trap. So if I can look at it in transmitted light, collect all this and look at it at the position of it all the time, then I can determine what sort of forces and torques are acting on the particle, and also determine the trajectory that the particle is going in and out of the tunnel. Okay, so this is a typical setup. So basically what we are showing here is that we have sort of mechano bits and pieces with which we can construct optical track. We yesterday on the blackboard decided that very little was needed for it. We said we needed high numerical aperture objective, here it is. We needed a laser, here it is. And here I have another laser, I'll tell you why. And then I have piezo stage, which enables me to control very precisely position of the particle, and also wiggle it with known frequency or whatever it is I want to do. And then in the transmitted light, I have, in the transmitted light, I have a condenser, and then the light is going, transmitted light is going to quadrant photodetector. And quadrant photodetector, you might not be aware, is just a segmented detector where, which looks, does everybody know how quadrant detector works? No? Okay. Okay, so it's rather simple. It's a detector. Light-sensitive detector, which is divided into four quadrants. And basically, the light comes onto the quadrant, and if it is in the middle, then of course the signals, I measure the signals in each one of the segments, and I can add them, and I can subtract them, and I can do all sorts of manipulations of it. And that would give me, so the signal, of course, is changing if the position of the light on it is changing, and it's very sensitive to that sort of manipulation of light. So that's quadrant detector. So what we also have in this setup is another laser, which we call detection beam laser, and sometimes it is used and sometimes not. But what it enables me to do is that in this particular picture, what I'm doing is that I'm actually only looking how this red light is behaving on my quadrant detector, rather than looking at the trapping light, how that is behaving. And that, it's a little bit of discussion about it, whether it's better or worse, or whether it adds anything or not. But in any case, what we believe is that the red laser is not incredibly highly focused. So if the particle is moving very slightly through changes in the trapping beam, this red beam will be very sensitively recording what's happening with it. But you can detect both of those beams, and people sort of would argue that what I just said wasn't quite right. Okay, so here again is the picture that we saw before. The particle is trapped three-dimensionally, and what I'm trying to show you here, just impress you how wonderfully we can do it, but also I have listed just few examples of where this sort of technology can be used. So it can be used in biophysics, it can be used in soft condensed matter physics, it can be used, it's starting to be used in quantum physics as well. What I will do now is to show you very few examples of the use of optical tweezers and a little bit of analysis of that. So what we have here is the manipulation of an organelle within the cell. So what you can see here is a cell which is attached to the microscope slide, but it's living cell. And then we have grabbed some sort of part of the cell. Don't ask me what part it is. My biology friends are telling me that actually it's something that the macrophage has gobbled up. So it's some sort of dirt that we actually are manipulating. But what I'm trying to show here is that we can trap it and move it from up there to about down there with optical forces. So if you want to study organelles within the cells, you can trap them, you can move them around, but that's only a nice picture, but you also can at the same time measure what sort of forces are acting while you are doing it and how those forces vary in different parts of the cell. So that's one example. And another example, so now I will show you how we can measure those forces. So the typical setup for measurement of forces is that, let's have the whole thing up. Okay, so what we have here is, I told you that we are using trapping laser. So here is my neodymium YAG laser, or fiber laser, or whatever it happens to be. The most important thing is that it's about 1 micron wavelength, or 1064 or 1070 nanometers, and it's going to my trap where I have my piezo stage, and I can look at the transmitted light, and I can look at it by either transmitted light, either by looking at the extra red laser, which then is sent to QPD, or I can also equally well, depending on what sort of filters I put in, I could also be tracking transmission of the green of the infrared light. But in this case, what I'm describing is that I trap the particle of the green light, and then I follow its movements in on my QPD by looking at the HeMe laser transmission through the particle. We also have here just normal white light illumination to be able to take the pictures that I was showing before. So I have CCD camera which can take pictures here. Otherwise, I can also have very fast camera there. This is what I was telling you before, that I could put very sophisticated fast camera with many shots per very short, time slots, and I can look at the behavior of the particle not only with my QPD but also with the CCD camera. So the force measurement again. There are several ways of measurement of the forces in optical tweezers. So we can measure escape force. So what it means is what I was describing yesterday, that I can trap the particle, pull the stage with certain acceleration, and see what sort of acceleration I need for the particle to fall out of the trap. Then I can measure that. And in order to do it, I need a position-sensitive detector or quadrant detector. I have to be able to apply null force. And if I want to measure the position of and the trap stiffness, you could see that normally you could look at, oops, it doesn't want to move. Okay, if I don't dare, you can look. So any particles in a liquid surrounding will experience rapid motion, and I can measure that. Or I can do the position calibration. Okay? So we will do that. And this is what I was showing you before, that depending on the power of the incoming laser, I can look at how they curve the stiffness, the power spectrum for the particle looks like. And so what we are doing here is that we are varying the incoming power of the laser. And you can see that if the laser power is very low, the trapping stiffness is very, very low. And if I, however, increase the power several times, you can see that the trap stiffness becomes very strong. And I can measure it very, very carefully, very, very specifically. So position calibration is shown here. So I have 2 micron-sized polystyrene particle. And yeah, I'm scanning it over the detector region, so this detector region is like my QPD there. And I plot this normalized signal versus the position of the particle in X, Y, and Z. And you can see that, again, by studying the normalized signal, we can determine the entire force curve for the particle in the trap. Okay, so if I want to measure the force in absolute terms, I need the position calibration and stiffness measurement. So this is my simple model. So this is just a little particle on a spring. And so the force acting on it is the stiffness times the extension that the particle experiences. And so the experiment will look something like this. That I have my incoming light, I have my sphere which is moving, then it means that in the condenser what I will see is that the light is moving on my detector, so this is how it will look like. So depending on the position of the particle, the position of this detected light on QPD will be changing, and I will be plotting it, and this is what I will get. Okay, and if I analyze it further, I can see that if I have non-applied drag force, I can then measure the force, and you can see that it's a straight line, and it fits the measurement fits very well the curve that we were expecting to have. So now, applications of that, as I said, I don't know whether you can see it, probably not, because I can't, so we skip this one. This was just an example of trapping an entire cell. So basically, I trap the cell and I can move it in three dimensions. Another applications of optical tweezers in slightly different geometry, and I won't have much time to go through that geometry in details, but instead of having single tweezers, you take two fibers through which you send laser light, and you might know that when the light is sent through the fiber, it diverges very rapidly after coming out. So here is my light coming out of the first fiber, here's the light coming off the second fiber, and they are very well aligned, so this is a bit tricky to do, but you can do it. And then I put a red blood cell in between these beams. The red blood cell will be trapped, and then I can try to look at the elasticity of the red blood cell. And it has been postulated and shown that the healthy blood cell has very much different elasticity to for example, cancer blood cells. So in order to determine the elasticity, what we do here is that we change the power in the laser, one of the lasers, and then the particles and the red blood cell will stretch. And I can measure that stretching and I can determine the elasticity of it. And as I said, the elasticity, it has been proven that the elasticity of the cells, healthy cells, is very different to sick cells. Okay, so this is how it works. And here you can see two snapshots of what is happening when you put it into the so-called stretcher then. So here, the forces exerted on it from both beams are equal, so the red blood cell looks pretty round. However, if you're stretching it, you can deform it, and you can measure this deformation very easily. So in practice, how it is done, it's a very slow process, and therefore it is used commercially, but not very often. And basically what you can do is that you can use normal tweezers to bring the particle into the stretcher, and then you can do the stretching and measurements of how much you stretch it independently in the stretcher. And here is a little thing to impress you with, what can be done with this type of trap. So what we see here is basically we have the two fibers, that's the core of the fiber we can see, and so light is coming through and the particle is being trapped, so we can flow them through, or we can bring them with optical tweezers, so this is brought with optical tweezers. And what you can see, what is characteristic and quite interesting to study, and people have studied it a lot, is that they clump together, but then depending, someone can have quite a nice necklace here built between the fibers. And then if I start playing with the power in those fibers, I can look at another phenomenon. I can also, so I can move them from side to side, I can separate them, and look what happens. And all that can be measured, and what you would say, what is it good for? Well, basically you are looking at the force, so you should be asking me what's the phenomenon behind this, the guy there in glasses, he wanted to know. And this is basically that if you have these two laser lights, which are coming towards each other, and they are the same, they are same wavelengths, and they are coherent, there will be a lot of, it will be like a standing wave in between, which will have nodes, very many nodes in there. And the question is, where is this particle trapped? Is it trapped in the center, in the maximum, or in the minimum? And how does the pattern, interference pattern, influence what is happening to these particles can be very interesting to study. And people have done a lot of studies of that sort. We'll skip this one. Okay. And another example, which is really showing how this sensitive detectors can be used for measurement of displacements, is shown in this slide. And there's a lot of work going on in the molecular motors. And optical tweezers can be used for looking at, for example, kinesing walking along the microtubule. And so what is done here is that I have my microtubule and I can put kinesin onto the bead. So the bead is really huge, and this kinesin, of course, is attached to it, and then it attaches itself to this microtubule. And then when it walks along, what will happen is that, of course, the position of this, as this kinesin is attached to the bead, if the kinesin is walking along, the position of this bead will slightly vary. And if I have a detector here, I can then detect how this walking is taking place. Okay, so here is the example of it. Now it doesn't want to play. Nah, what's going on? Okay. I'm pushing the buttons too quickly or something. I'm not quite sure what I'm doing at the moment. Okay. It didn't want to play, but what I was going to show you, okay, decided not to play, media unavailable. Okay. So here we can see hardly, but little bit, we can see the microtubule, and here is the trap B, which has kinesin attached to it. And if the film would play, what it would show you is that it moves along this microtubule, and then we can analyze the movement very precisely by looking at the trap. I noticed that there was another interesting thing that I wanted to show you, and it is that we can use spatial light modulators to produce more than one trap. These are the traps produced in three dimensions, and with spatial light modulator, I can refresh the spatial light modulator dynamically. And so what I have here are four beads, which then are trapped in X, Y, and Z, and I change the Z and I change the Y in position and in X, and you can see how they follow the trap. So here it is in three dimensions. And then you can play like this as well. So this is the last particle. Then you have many, many beads which are trapped. And then you manipulate your SNM algorithm. And then you can create a line of beads somewhere where you want them. What it is supposed to show you is that it's a highly flexible system where you can determine what it is you want to do and how you want to do it. So at the moment, the line is being built. Okay. And of course, I can now go in and with the same setup measure exactly what are the forces between these four particles and how are they varying in time. Okay, so another thing that you can do is you can look at cell adhesion. So this was a study that we had done some time ago. And so here we have a macrophage and we have a bead. And bead is either just normal bead or it's covered with some proteins, depending on what we want to study. And the most important thing is that what we are monitoring here is that I'm moving the stage with the macrophage towards the bead, which is sitting in optical trap. And somewhere here I have my detector, and you can see that when the macrophage is attached to the bead, the bead is attached to the macrophage, the bead is moving slightly when I'm retracting my cell. And I can look at it, and that's the model that we are doing it with. So the particle sits in the trap stably, and the macrophage comes towards it. I push it out, the bead is retracted, the force is changing here, I can measure that force, and then I can continue that. The bonding breaks, and I can measure how strong this bond is. Okay, and so to study that, the setup is very similar to what we had before. Again, it's all based upon being able to trace the position of the trapped particle in the quadrupole photodetector, and so this is what we are doing here. And basically, this is the traces that you, these are the traces that you will get in this sort of measurement. So if I'm coming towards the macrophage and no adhesion takes place, I'll have a little bit of change of transmitted light, and then when I retract the particle, it will go to the same non-signal situation as it was before. However, if adhesion does take place, you can see that this is the this is coming close to the cell, and then I am stretching the bond. Eventually, it breaks and it goes back. And the big thing about this, by using optical tweezers, is that I can measure the forces and bead position when it touches, and then all the forces which it takes to break the bonds. And in this particular example, we have quite a number of breaking points, and we can measure the stiffness of the trap, we can measure what sort of force is needed for breaking each individual bond, we can look at the, as I said, at the right chain. Okay, so this was just to show you that you can use this sort of physics for understanding bonding and breakage of bonds in adhesion processes. Yesterday somebody asked me how big are the particles, the maximum of particles that can be trapped. And in this work, which comes from Monica Rich-Martin's group, what they have done is that they have trapped really huge cells. This was done in a very interesting way. So this is slight modification of the tweezers. So basically, instead of just having high numerical aperture objective and then very tightly focused beam, what they have here is actually low numerical aperture objective, and then the beam is going towards the dichroic mirror, and then it's reflected. So in principle, what you have here is what I was showing you before. It's very similar to two fibers, except that this is three-dimensional. The trapping is three-dimensional here. And what it also gives opportunity to is not only that the particles which are trapped are very large, but also that there is a lot of space around it, because with lower numerical aperture objective, you have much more space to play with, and so you can do a lot of other reactions and stuff around it. What is also interesting, so you can see that this was, we are looking at force versus position, and the linearity of the force is very large in terms of how far from the equilibrium position you can go. So that's very interesting in being able to do. So this was done, of course, in water again. But the most important thing here is that it was in a reflected trap. Okay, so now I want to switch gears a little bit and go to approach again vortex fields. So I want to talk about rotation in optical tweezers. Okay, so I just want to start all my films and talk around them. Okay, so what we see here is that what I'm doing is I'm trapping different objects in different types of light. So here in this first one, what I'm doing is I have calcite crystal, which we have done in colloidal solution, produced in colloidal solution, so this is about 5 microns across. I'm putting circularly polarized light on it, and I'm trapping it, but not only am I able to trap it, but I'm also able to rotate it, okay? And it's stably rotating in a particular configuration. Okay, so the question is, how does it happen? Now in this one, I have glass shard, so this is elongated particle, which is made out of glass, so this is not birefringent. You know that calcite here is a birefringent crystal. However, this is not birefringent, and I illuminate it with circular polarized light, and it also rotates. The question is, why does that do that? Why does that happen? In this one, I'm producing spherical particles which are birefringent. So there are another calcium carbonate variety, which are called vaterites, and you can see, or it is hardly possible to see that they rotate because they are almost perfectly spherical, okay? But they rotate in laser light. So again, question why? And here, in this one, is actually something totally different. It is a rotation of dumbbell in Gauss-Laguerre monolight. Okay, so what I want to do in the few minutes now and then tomorrow is to try to analyze what is happening here. But what I really am interested in is this one. Because we were going to talk about orbital angular momentum and Gauss-Laguerre beams of light and what we can do with it. So then I want to analyze this in details and be able to measure orbital angular momentum which is being transferred to this dumbbell or other structures, and I want to measure it in situ. But in order to do that, there are several methods, and I will show you those, but in order to do that, one of the simplest methods is through understanding of what is happening in circularly polarized light. So therefore, I will talk first about circularly polarized light and rotation, and then go to orbital angular momentum. So what I want to do is I want to twist and turn as well as push and pull. So I want to have optical spanner and optical tweezers. I want to do it with known amount, so I want to be able to measure the torque. I want to use spin angular momentum or orbital angular momentum. And then, as I said, I want to measure the orbital angular momentum transfer. Okay, so as we said, exchange of angular momentum of light, we know it comes in terms of circularly polarized light or a helical wavefront which carries orbital angular momentum. So we have circularly polarized light, we have spin, orbital angular momentum from helicity of the wavefront, and then I want to calculate all this. Okay, so in summary, I think that I'm approaching the end of this one, is I'm just summarizing what I said to you before, is that I can have angular momentum in two shapes, spin angular momentum, that would mean that each photon is carrying plus minus h bar of angular momentum. So this is basically circularly polarized light, left-handed or right-handed circularly polarized light, and my electric field vector is describing a circle. Okay, so that's what you are seeing here. And then I can have orbital angular momentum. This is what we were talking about yesterday. So these are my Gauss-Laguerre beams of light. And as we said, depending on the charge, so one of the indices in Lagrangian polynomials, it, depending on the charge of this beam, each photon will carry plus minus charge times h bar of the photon of orbital angular momentum. Okay, so do I still have a few minutes?
Yes.
Okay. So circularly polarized light. Okay. So this is something that has been of great interest in physics for many, many years. So in 1934, Beth was trying to look at spin angular momentum transfer. experiment. So what he wanted to do is to have an object on the tension pendulum and then illuminate it by light and see how much it would turn when the circularly polarized light was coming to this onto this construction. So we passed circularly polarized light twice through lambda over 2 plate. Okay? So I have my incoming light, I put it through the lambda over 4 plate. So light here will be circularly polarized with its slow axis this way and fast axis this way. It comes onto this mirror and then it is transmitted through it, this onto this lambda over 2 plate, sorry, and then it's coming onto another lambda over 4 plate. So it is suspended on torsion fiber. So we can achieve here angular momentum transfer of 4 h bar per photon, and it was the first measurement of angular momentum of light in history. And I will stop here and continue with the rest of it tomorrow. How to measure and how to do that sort of measurement that took back quite a long time in a very simple way in optical physics. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So there's some time for questions if you can ask now or to break some questions now. Yes, please.
I was just wondering, when you
use
this say you have fast cameras, what does that mean?
Well, you know that normal CCD cameras have only 50 frames per second. So that's slow count. Okay. So if I go to kilohertz, then it's rather fast. And the cameras are getting better and better. So the speed of the camera for measurement of Brownian motion, if you really want to do minute measurements and high frequencies, what have you, 50 frames per second is very safe. So I'm talking about the cameras which kilohertz and hopefully soon megahertz.
Yes, there's no.
So it was interesting in the talk showing the size dependence of the force generation, trapping force. Have there been attempts to try to use that for separating particles?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Work?
So there's whole field which is using, it's called optical sorter. Rather than optical tweezers. And so what you want to do in optical sorter is to push them. So you really, in optical sorter, you're using scattering force rather than grabbing force. So you just push them. And of course, the scattering force depends very heavily upon the size of the particle. And the velocity. So as you push them, if you have mixture, pity I don't have that here, but if you have mixture of particles with different sizes, and you put it into focus laser beam, you can see that they just form a line of different sizes going with different speeds through it. So you can separate them.
Commercialized.
It is commercialized. It is commercialized. That part is commercialized. There are other methods of looking at separation of particles. You can do trapping in evanescent wave. So you can create a wave on the microscope slide. So you will have particular field very close within evanescent field, and you put particles on that, and then you can move evanescent field and you can move the particles. And that is also, that is not commercialized, but it's having
I guess I'm thinking of these ones where you have very fine size dependent.
Yes.
You imagine doing experiments where
so you are talking
the
properties
about of the particles are the same, they're very close in
yes.
size, maybe
yes.
only a few percent difference,
yes.
but you're
So commercial apparatus to that is flow cytometry. Flow cytometry is based upon shining the laser light and looking at fluorescence. It's very sensitive to the size, and it's incredibly fast. So the problem with this method is that they're not that fast. But if you want to use it with microfluidic devices, for example, so that's great way of doing it. So you can do it one by one through microfusion device, or you can do it by sorting the cell.
Any other questions? Let's have the coffee break. There are some for the transportation that can be offered up to a staple the day. Is 256 grams. 36.